Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to our Good Friday service here at Balhelvie, and a special welcome if you're visiting with us tonight. You're very welcome. First of all, well done in finding your way to Balhelvie Church. If you haven't been here before, it's not the easiest to find, but hopefully you'll know your way second time round. It's lovely to have you. If you're able to join us for a tea or a coffee after the service, you would be most welcome, and that'll be served in the Forsyth Hall just behind me here at the back of the church. A welcome to our friends from Fovran. I see some Fovran friends along tonight, and also to our friends from Ellen, and it's lovely to welcome you to worship now as the beginning of our moving towards a parish grouping over the next couple of years. And thank you for your hospitality to us last night in Ellen for your Maundy Thursday service. It was great to be with you in worship. Don't really have many announcements to make tonight other than to say that we will be having our Easter early morning, and I say early morning advisedly, service at 9 o'clock. Other congregations will be up, you know, Munro's at 6 a.m. with head torches. We meet in Potterton Park this coming Sunday at 9 o'clock. So you're welcome to join us there for a wee short service to welcome Easter morning. But beyond that, I think other than to say at the end of the service, there will be a benediction, but then we'll leave the service in quiet afterwards and make our way across to the hall if we're staying. So those are all our announcements. So let's begin our service tonight by worshipping God in the words of hymn number 378, Praise to the Holiest in the Height. Thank you. Let's join our hearts together in prayer now. Let us pray. God of the green hill, God of city walls, God of temple court and country lane, God of hill and valley, desert and shoreline, ploughed field and wilderness, God of time and space and turning galaxies, burning stars, dying suns. The world should sit at your feet this evening. Lights should be dimmed, curtains drawn, voices stilled, in readiness for this remembrance. For what we remember this night is that when you came into the world did not receive you. When you took a face and lived among us, the world failed to recognize you. You came to offer life, but we sentenced you to death. For the life you offer means death to our pretense to be our own gods. And that's something we won't take from anyone. And so tonight, this part of the story comes to a head. The hosannas of Sunday have long since faded away. Judas' plans gather momentum. The disciples sleep while your soul groans in Gethsemane. Peter draws his sword to defend you and then denies you three times just a few hours later. Only a few will remain with you till the bitter end. Were you there when they crucified my Lord, goes the old song. Yes, we were there. As guilty as the next man or woman who turned away or shouted for Barabbas or scoffed as you stumbled on the Via Dolorosa. As guilty as those who flayed your back, tore your clothes, swung a mallet, drove home the nails. And yet with your dying breath, flecked with bloody spittle, and spoken through broken teeth, love crucified prayed, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. True of those who killed you, but true in so many ways of the entire human race. Lights should be dimmed, curtains drawn, voices stilled, in readiness for this awesome, awful revelation of the depths of human sin and the limitless horizon of your redeeming love. Father, forgive us, for we don't know what we're doing. Lord, may we recognize ourselves and recognize you in what we hear this evening, and take our place among those who, having understood what happened at Calvary so long ago, take up our own crosses and follow in Christ's way. Amen. Our next hymn is number 374, From Heaven You Came, Helpless Babe.
Enter our world, your Lord. So listen, if you will, for the word of God as it's found in Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer by night, and am not silent.
Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the praise of Israel. In you our fathers put their trust. They trusted and you delivered them. They cried to you and were saved. In you they trusted and were not disappointed.
But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by men and despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts the Lord. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him.
Yet you brought me out of the womb. You made me trust in you, even at my mother's breast. From birth, I was cast upon you. From my mother's womb, you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near and there is no one to help.
Many bulls surround me. Strong bulls of Bashan encircle me. Roaring lions tearing their prey, open their mouths wide against me. I am poured out like water and all my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax. It has melted within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. Dogs have surrounded me. A band of evil men has encircled me. They've pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing. But you, O Lord, be not far off. O my strength, come quickly to help me. Deliver my life from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dogs. Rescue me from the mouth of the lions. Save me from the horns of the wild oxen.
I will declare your name to my brothers in the congregation. I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel. For he has not despised or disdained the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help. From you comes the theme of my praise in the great assembly. Before those who fear you will I fulfill my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. They who seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord. And all the families of the nations will bow down before him, for dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship. All who go down to the dust will kneel before him, those who cannot keep themselves alive. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness to a people yet unborn. For he has done it. Amen. Let's take a moment to pray together. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Preaching on Good Friday is a huge honour, but it's also immensely daunting. You want to get things right. You want to handle the subject reverently and carefully, because the cross is nothing less than a window into the very heart and character of God. And you're also very conscious that no words you can bring will ever do the events of Good Friday justice. Silent worship, awe, penitence, and gratitude are the only fitting responses to God's self-offering in Christ on Calvary. And that's why we're going to spend some time later on after the sermon just simply sitting at the foot of the cross, listening to some music, seeing some images, but being there in adoration of our crucified God. But before then, there are some words to reckon with. But they're Jesus' words, not mine. Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? What an appalling thing to hear from Jesus' lips. The man who knew God like nobody else, whose every action and word and thought flowed from that deep connection with the Father, who taught his followers to call God Abba, Daddy, because that's the way we should think of him. But now apparently, Daddy was nowhere to be found. Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. Matthew and Mark both tell us that Jesus didn't whisper those words under his breath in a moment of private anguish. That's what we might have expected him to do. Instead, he yelled them out above the heads of the crowd with whatever strength he could muster. So somehow it seemed to be important that other people get to hear him say these words. But why? Why? Over the last few years, I've come to an understanding of why this might have been, and that's what I want to share with you this evening. So if I were brave enough, or maybe stupid enough, to stand up here tonight and to sing the first line of The Lord's My Shepherd to the tune Crimmond, I'm pretty sure that almost everybody would be able to join in for the remaining five verses, because we're Presbyterians, and if there's one thing we know, it's the 23rd Psalm. Well, the Jews of Jesus' day knew a few more Psalms than just the 23rd. They were schooled in all of them, and many would have known all of the Psalms off by heart. So when Jesus shouted, my God, why have you forsaken me? People would have known straight away that he was quoting Psalm 22. And they would have thought to do the one thing that we often forget to do, which is to look beyond the first verse of the psalm and see what the rest of it says. So much theology of the cross has been built around our understanding just of verse 1. Was Jesus literally abandoned by his Father in those moments in some way? Or was he entering into the shared human experience of feeling at times utterly abandoned by God? Did the Father actually turn his face away at the moment of his Son's greatest need? Or is there some other dynamic going on in that moment? Those are good questions, important questions. But rather than speculating or theologizing about them, what if we do what I think Jesus meant us to do with this cry from the cross and remember the rest of the psalm? In
In some ways, Psalm 22 has a very familiar flow to it. Lots of the Psalms start out with the writer feeling abandoned or lost or bereft, asking where God is and if he's ever going to stir himself to intervene in some way. And that's part of the reason that we love the Psalms. It's their brutal honesty about the human condition and the permission that they give us to come to God exactly as we are, with no pretense. He can handle our emotions, good or bad. It's our apathy that he doesn't seem to have much time for. So very often the psalmists begin in a bad place and they set out their stall, they have a good gripe about everything that's gone wrong, but then usually somewhere about halfway to two-thirds of the way through the psalm, once they've got all of that stuff off their chest, there comes a turn in the psalm as they begin to quieten down and start remembering. They start remembering the stories of their ancestors or parts of their own personal journey, the parts where God heard their cries and showed up and turned things around, even if it was only to give them enough strength to get through whatever it was they were enduring. As I thought about that today, I remembered leading a church weekend away for a church that I worked in Glasgow many years ago. And I asked them at one point to recall a time in their lives when they felt that God was especially close to them. And you know, we might have expected, oh, it was that beautiful sunny day when I climbed the mountains and the clouds parted, and or I heard the birds in the trees. And there was a lot of that, which is wonderful and true. But about two-thirds of the people there, and there were about 70 to 80 there, two-thirds of the people said that their deepest encounter with God had come at a time when they were bereft, down at heart, when they were bereaved, when they were worried, struggled. It came in the times of difficulty. God did not turn away from them in their struggles. He was with them profoundly, and they felt it. And that remembrance of God's faithfulness in the difficult times begins to kindle hope in the psalmists as they write their psalms. They remember that God had heard and that God had been with them, and that gave them confidence that God would be with them in whatever was coming, because that's who he is from beginning to end, our loving heavenly Father. And I think that's exactly the flow that we are seeing in Psalm 22, a flow from despair into hope. But we have to take the whole psalm. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me? So far from the words of my groaning. There's the despair. But by verse 3, the psalmist is already beginning to remind himself of who God is and what he's done. You are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the praise of Israel. In you, our fathers put their trust. They trusted and you delivered them. So there's a glimmer of hope coming through there in the darkness as he remembers God's faithfulness to his people in the past. That hope gets shaken when he hears the sneers of the passers-by. He trusts in the Lord. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. In other words, if God loved you, you wouldn't be in the mess you're in just now. Don't you understand that you're only in this trouble because he's abandoned you? That's what they wanted him to think. Again, the psalmist looks back on this long history of trusting in God, and he finds hope. You brought me out of the womb, he says. You made me trust you even at my mother's breast. From birth I was cast upon you. From my mother's womb, you have been my God. In the face of that opposition, he's remembering who God is and who he is in God. And he needs that, because things are going to get really ugly really soon. This next section of the psalm is really remarkable. This, we think, is one of David's psalms, written something like 1,000 years before Christ was born, but the detail in it could not be closer to what actually happened to Jesus at the crucifixion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax. It has melted away within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. Dogs have surrounded me. A band of evil men has encircled me. They've pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing. It's stunningly accurate from a distance of a millennium. Following straight on from that is a section of the psalm that sounds very much like a prayer. But you, O Lord, be not far off. O my strength, come quickly to help me. Deliver my life from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dogs. And we might well wonder if that prayer was answered for Jesus, because we know that he died. That the dogs of empire and politics and religion had their way and tore him to shreds, and he let them do their worst to him when he could have chosen otherwise. But we know too with hindsight that although it's Friday, Sunday's coming. And with Sunday comes deliverance and new life, not just for Jesus, but for the whole cosmos. And it's at this point in the psalm that the turn comes. And the writer's move from despair to hope is almost complete, because he remembers that however things are and however they turn out, God has his back. I will declare your name to my brothers, he says. In the congregation, I will praise you. Praise him. Honor him, revere him, he says to his hearers. Why? Because God has not despised or disdained the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help. Despite how things seemed and how they felt, God has not hidden his face from the psalmist. He's seen his suffering, he's heard his cry, and he will bring deliverance. And you may choose to think differently, but I've come to believe that the same is true of Christ on the cross. I believe that the Father and the Spirit were there with Jesus every step of the way, looking him full in the face, looking on in grief, and willing him courage, even when he couldn't feel their presence with him. Looking on like a parent holding a child's hand as he wrestles in the grip of a nightmare fever. Or a husband holding his wife's hand as she cries in the agony of labor and struggles to bear the life that they've conceived together. I believe God's with him. The Father's with him all the way. In the space of this one psalm, Psalm 22, why have you forsaken me? Gives way to, you have not hidden your face from me, but have listened to my cry for help. And that's what I think Jesus wanted us to know, that he was seen and heard by God in his suffering. And so are we. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, Isaiah says of him in the servant song, Isaiah 53. All that brings us pain, and all the pain we bring, all the wrong we do, and all the wrong that's done to us, Jesus took it all into himself and absorbed it in order to heal it and forgive it. To become, in living a fully perfect human life as no one had done, to become our new head, our second Adam, who brings reconciliation with God, not estrangement, and liberates us from the power of sin and death rather than consigning us to them. And that's why we have this marvelous, expansive ending to the psalm. It begins, Psalm 22, with one man's despair, but it ends with joyful hope for the whole world. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him, for dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness to people yet unborn. For he has done it. He has done it. And doesn't that last line echo Jesus' final words on the cross as we have them in John's Gospel? It is finished. What's finished, we might ask? Well, it's not just the spiritual and physical suffering that he endured on the cross. What was finished in that moment was God's whole plan of redemption through Christ that he purposed from the beginning of time. The plan that saw Jesus live the life that we couldn't live and die the death that we should have died so that we could be liberated for the friendship with God that we were always destined for. In a wonderful paradox, it's Jesus' agony and death on the cross that usher in the new life that God wants us all to enter and is blessing us with. New life that in a few days' time will issue from the dark womb of the garden tomb. New life whose strong arms lifted Adam's helpless race up from the depths of separation and despair and carried us in love back into the joyful communion of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Is finished. He has done it. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit for their work of salvation, not just for some, but for all in Christ. Going to take some time now just to listen to a piece of music called Agnus Dei, which means Lamb of God, and it's a choral arrangement of Barber's Adagio for strings. And if you listen carefully, you'll hear the very same movement from despair and into hope and resolution that we read in Psalm 22. And I'd invite you just to use this time as you would like to. Close your eyes if you want to, focus on the music, focus on the images that will appear in the screen if that helps. But let's give this time over to God as we humble ourselves before this great mystery of our faith, that the Lord of life would submit to the cross and scorn its shame for the sake of love. We're going to pray together now, and in this prayer later on, we're going to come to some responses. When I say, Lord, have mercy, I'd invite you to respond, Christ, have mercy. And let's pray together. We take a moment now to come to God in recognition of our sin and our complicity in Christ's death. Lord Jesus, the religious leaders spent hours plotting in the darkness, thinking of nothing but their own survival. Forgive us for our introspection and the ways in which knowingly and unknowingly we place our own needs and concerns above those of others. Lord Jesus, they took you, stripped you, and beat you till you were scarcely recognizable to your family and friends. Forgive us for the choices we make which bring pain to others and blind us to the consequences of our actions. Lord Jesus, they crucified you with a sign above your head reading King of the Jews in three different languages. Forgive us when we're too quick to label others, forgetting that each one is made and known and loved by you. Forgive us, Lord, as in a moment of silence we make our own confession to you. Lord God, if we have hope of forgiveness and progress, it is only in your cross, where love and justice meet and find their eternal resolution. So hear our prayers and lead us on in newness of life from this evening onwards. And as you gave yourself for the life of the world, so we pray together for the life of the world. We remember those folk enduring agony of body, soul, and mind today, struggling with pain that seems beyond them. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. We remember those treated as today's scapegoats, people who are persecuted because they seem different or strange to us. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. We remember those who feel powerless in the face of social or political forces that they can't possibly overcome, remembering especially the ongoing crisis in the land of your birth. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. We remember all who are keeping company with someone who's dying, trying to make their last days and hours as meaningful as possible. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. We remember a world that has largely forgotten you and goes about its business with little understanding of the sacrifice you made for us. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Holy God, Father, Son, and Spirit, we bless you for going out to us in redeeming love, showing solidarity with us in the incarnation, gathering us up into the finished work of Christ and commissioning us to live as ambassadors of reconciliation. So send us out in hope and faith to take up our crosses and to follow where you lead, because we ask it all in Christ's name. And in his name we pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. closing hymn is number 383, While Mary Was Watching. And now go in the hard-won peace that Christ has graced you with, in giving up his life for the world. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen. Please be seated.